Simon Townsend's Wonderworld, episode number 329-1, XC9576, recorded the 4th of the 3rd of 86, transmission the 24th of the 3rd of 86, Melbourne, Sydney, Brisbane and Adelaide.
This is Simon Townsend's Wonderworld on March the 24th, and here's something that's absolutely true. The definition of willpower. Willpower is eating only one peanut. Oh, that's true. Hello and welcome to my wonder world. Lord Howe Island, an amazing island surrounded by a reef that contains marine organisms that have been carried down by warm currents from the Great Barrier Reef and even New Caledonia. Now, Melinda Rutter took a trip in a glass-bottom boat around Ned's Beach to film this story.
The boat, and of course it's got a glass bottom. One glass bottom, and this is it. It's like having a window to the sea. It's great. Except you're not supposed to sit here. The sea is full of so many coloured sponges and corals, there's actually soft coral, which you can see moving in the water. The soft coral is still being built. And when it's finished, it goes to what we know as hard coral. Lord Howe Island is actually 10 kilometres in length, and the coral reef surrounds the whole island. Some parts of the reef are actually quite deep, but you can actually see the bottom because the water's so clear, it's beautiful. And other parts are really shallow. Now, at low tide, you can actually see the top of the reefs. It's great. All the fish in these waters are actually subtropical. Now, there's something like 400 different species of fish in these waters, and they reckon there's no sharks. That's probably because they've got so many fish. This is one of the little animals that you might find at the bottom of the reef, and it's a sea urchin. Now, these are very spiky, as you can see, and along the spikes, their edges are actually serrated, so if you tread on them, boy, it's going to hurt. So if you go on the coral reef, wear sand shoes. As well as seeing all the beautiful coral reefs, they actually put on a floor show for you. This guy dives down under the water and feeds this fish by hand. And this fish's name's Albert. And Albert's been waiting for 10 years every lunchtime to be fed. I reckon he's spinning the guan myself. They even feed the fish with bread. I mean, they throw it out into the ocean and they chase it just like dogs. I didn't know you could tame fish.
It's fascinating, isn't it? That's at Lord Howe Island. I'll be back after this break with a music clip and then a story on new chairs that look like antiques. After midnight. Music now by one of my favourite performers, Elton John, and this is called Nikita, and the entire music clip takes place around the Berlin Wall that separates East and West Germany, and it's about a soldier, about a girl named Nikita. Now, once again, Elton looks fantastic in the most wonderful gear. Watch out for his giant boots. Cute, isn't it? I love it. Antiques. I really love them too, especially antique chairs. But as they become scarce, they become more expensive and very difficult to find. However, thanks to ready-made antiques, that's mass-producing antique-looking chairs, they're relatively inexpensive now and easier to come by. Here's Philip Tanner.
This style of chair was first introduced in 1905. That's why it's got this antique look. They were very popular for quite a few years, but then they got to be too expensive, so they went out of mode. And then about 10 years ago, everyone wanted one, but couldn't get one, so they were reintroduced. Hi, I'm Philip.
Hi, I'm an antique chair.
OK, it's time to show you how they're made. Firstly, they bring in tons and tons of wood, and this is mainly pine wood. The really long lengths they have to cut down to size, but they also get some bits of wood in that are already shaped. And they put these through a machine known as a lathe, which spins it round and makes the legs. Of course, sitting on a flat piece of wood gets pretty uncomfortable after a while, so they have to put in what's known as the saddle, and that's shaping this section here for your bottom to sit on, so that makes it nice and cozy. And then they shape the seat itself, and then they drill the holes that you can put all your legs and also the back of the chair in with. Now that's boring. One of the things that really gives these antique chairs an antique feel and an antique look is this, and that is the pressing which is on the back of the chair. That's done on this press. You see, they heat it up and then they roll it on and it comes out looking like this. And now comes the fun part, the assembly. Yep, they get all the bits and pieces together and then they form our chair. The interesting thing about these chairs is that they don't use nails or staples, they simply use glue. And the fact that these type of chairs have been around since early this century and they're still holding together means that that's a pretty good way to go. Chairs then need to be sanded down and polished, which really gives them their antique look. I guess you're wondering why I've gathered you all here. Well, it's mainly to show you off to our viewers and to quickly explain to you that these chairs range in price from $100 to $150, and they make between 100 and 150 chairs here every day. You might think, where do they sell all those chairs to? But when you consider how many chairs you've got at home and how many people in Australia have backsides that need to sit down, then you can see there's a rather large market. Oh. The chairs we've seen being made aren't the only things that they make that look like antiques. They've also got these dressing tables, they've got higher chairs, they've got stools, and they've even got this convertible table that makes itself either shorter or longer. Well, I guess by now you've overdosed with excitement, so it's time to show you how to sit down on the chair properly. This is for those who don't know. Firstly, make sure your chair is positioned correctly and flat on the floor. Then simply stand in front, bend your legs, and you'll sit like that. It really is as simple as that. Oh.
For everyone except Phil, I'll be back with a record breaker, an amazing record breaker who skates, and then a story on smoking fish. They taste terrific. And today's record breaker is Tracy Mangan, and she writes to me, Simon, I've been speed skating for 2 years, and here I am receiving a gold medal for the 300-metre sprint. That day I won 2 gold, 9 silver, 6 bronze, and 2 other trophies. That's not bad. Tracy, for you, the Guinness Book of Records, you might even be there one day with that kind of speed skating. Have a look at this. This is the tallest fountain in Britain. There's a taller one somewhere else in the world, but this one is 79 metres or 260 feet tall. It's a long way to shoot water up in the air. Right, story. Smoked fish. Now, smoked fish tastes absolutely delicious, and it's an excellent way of preserving fish. Fish spoils very quickly, and by smoking it, it lasts longer and it gives a very... It gives a very smoky flavour, I guess. The method of smoking foods has been around for centuries. And here's Melinda Rutter with more on this mouth-watering subject.
The first thing that has to be done is the fish are clean and then they're gutted. Then the fish are soaked in brine. Not brine, but B-R-I-N-E, which is a really heavy salt and water solution. And they're left in there for about an hour and a half to 2.5 hours, depending, of course, on the size of your fish. Then the fish are put onto racks and they're left to dry overnight. Then the fish go into these special ovens. Now, inside these ovens at the bottom is a fire with, of course, wood burning, and that's how they're cooked. First of all, they cook, and then they're smoked, and it smells absolutely beautiful. And the oven's about 210 degrees Celsius, and they stay in there for 4 to 9 hours. But on a dry day, they cook quicker, and on a wet day, they cook slower. Interesting trivia. Smoky. What we've just seen is called hot smoking. Now this is called cold smoking. Now down the bottom isn't a fire but smouldering sawdust. Let me tell you, it's really smoky and it doesn't get any higher than 100 degrees Celsius in here, and the fish have to stay in here for 7 to 8 hours. Now before you eat one of these fish, you have to actually cook it because it's not cooked in the cold smoking process. Now it's preserved with this smoking action and also gives a nice smoky flavour. If I don't get out of here, I can't talk anymore, my eyes. Dominic, what did you have for breakfast?
Of course, smoked fish.
Oh, how long have you been smoking fish?
13 years.
Boy, that's a long time. How'd you learn to do it?
Well, we learned from an old chap that he broke his tradition from the old country.
All right. Dominic, I don't mean to be offensive or anything, but is it a smelly business?
A little bit.
Why?
Because I'm losing all my friends.
Oh, no. Dominic smokes lots and lots of different types of fish, and out of the goodness of my heart and great expense to the management, here they are. There's Taylor, gemfish, New Zealand blue cod, trout, Tasmanian scallops, even herrings. As well as all these yummy fishies, they've got yummy smoked meats and they even make pate here. Okay, guys, rip it night!
Yummy, yummy smoked fish. Now it's time for a report from one of the many reporters in the field, our young reporters, our newshounds. And today's newshound is Mark Tilbrook, and he reports to me, Simon, my two sisters and I recently visited Old Sydney Town, where we had an old-fashioned photo taken in sepia. We dressed in colonial outfits and posed very properly for the photo. It was great fun. Good on you. For you, Mark, this fantastic gumball machine. This comes from Granny May's paper shop, and you put a coin in here, your own money, and you turn the knob like that, and out comes a gumball down there. It's a good way, too, for you to save coins. Sell them to your friends. Isn't it great? Gumball machine. Also, a game for you. This is called Connect Four, and it's like a vertical checkers game. It's really great fun, makes you think, and it comes from a company called The Games House. And here's something unusual. This is terrific. This is a copy of a paper called Kids Times. It's a very interesting children's newspaper. It's full of news items and games and photos and all sorts of things to read and do. And I'm going to send you a year's subscription, and that's compliments of Kids Times. Right, coming up, right after this commercial break, a story on animation. That's the process of making cartoons.
Simon loves to reply to your letters, but remember you must also send a second envelope. And this second envelope must have your name and your address on it. And it must have another stamp on it too, if you want your photo returned by Simon.
Awful having whiskers floating everywhere. Cartoons, don't you love them? The amazing thing about a cartoon is that it's made up of hundreds of individual pictures, thousands. Each picture is hand-drawn and then it's coloured in. And this whole process is called animation. You'd be surprised just how involved the whole process is. So here's my reporter to show you more, Philip Tanner.
Excuse me.
Animation is the technique of making motion picture cartoons come to life through a series of drawings. And a feature length, which could be about an hour and a half, could take up to a million pictures, separate little pictures, and also 3 years to complete. You've been in the game for 22 years, so what fascination does animation hold for you?
Bringing all those pencil drawings to life.
Right, so what is normally still suddenly goes and appears.
That's right, yep.
But don't you get bored doing the same thing over and over?
Oh, no, because you're doing a different drawing, you're doing a different character, you're doing a different thing every time.
Right, what sort of skills do you need if you want to become an animator?
The skills are drawing and just lots of it. You've just got to have a lot of drawing practice.
Animation starts with an idea. Someone says, hey, I've got this great idea. What we have is we have this little bird that falls out of a chimney and goes splat on the ground and then goes, ooh, like this. So then he hands this idea to the animator. The animator then does a storyboard, which is a comic strip, which depicts how the animation is going to end up looking, but in a really rough form. A piece of animation we're seeing doesn't have any sound, but normally after you've done the storyboard is where they put the sound down. You can either have music or voices, and voices is when it becomes difficult. You see, for every 1 second on screen there have to be 24 different diagrams, so a word like wonder, which takes about 1/3 of a second to say, needs a few different diagrams just to get the character's mouth saying the word wonder. Let's take a look at some of the equipment you're going to need to draw the animation. For a start, you've got your animation disc, plus you've got a light box. You see, this lights up from underneath through this bit of perspex, so you can see what you're drawing. You've also got your peg bars, and the good thing about the peg bars is that they not only keep your paper straight, but they also can tell you exactly where you need to put your characters. You're going to need a chart, which tells the cameraman exactly what he's got to do, plus you've got a variety of pens, pencils, and cutters. So now it's time to get the little characters off the storyboard and onto paper. The way they do this is they run it through a, literally like a scheme. You have your underneath character and then the one on the top, which shows you how the character should go. So for example, we've got this long stretched out one. We know as he hits the ground that he's got to squash up. So that's exactly what Don is doing now. Our little character is now on the cell and it's time to paint him. And using simple household paints with a variety of colours, you paint the back of them. And have a look at this.
I wish my life was a non-stop Hollywood movie show. A fantasy world of celluloid villains and heroes. Because celluloid heroes never feel any pain.
With all the cells painted and looking good, it's time to photograph them. Now, this is a special animation camera. Normal motion picture cameras run at 24 or 25 frames a second, as you can hear, whereas this one takes just single shots. So every cell you put down, you take one shot of it, then you replace it with the next one. You get your film processed, and then it comes back looking like this, with your characters all the way down the film, similar to all these other commercials and such we've got in the background. Well, that's animation. It is as simple as that.
Not all that simple, but fascinating. It's time to go, but before I do, just have a look at this novelty mug. This comes from a restaurant called Hog Heaven. The tea or coffee comes in this harmless-looking mug, just looks a bit of a different shape there. But when you tip it up to drink from it, it looks like that. Comes from Hog Heaven. There you go. Till next time, please remember, yep, the world really is wonderful. Bye.
I'd like to be under the sea, in an octopus's garden, in the shade. He'd let us in, knows where we've been, in his octopus's garden, in the shade. I'd ask my friends to come and see an octopus's garden with me. I'd like to be.
Where do ghosts live?
Where do ghosts live?
In a territory.